So our next professor comes all the way, or our next speaker comes to us all the way from New York City, Professor Brian Brenberg. First, we'd like to welcome all of our online attendees, and we'd like to encourage you to head on over to yaf.org/virtualpass if you're streaming from elsewhere. There you'll be able to ask questions, and you'll be able to download our speaker's PowerPoint. Professor Brenberg serves as Executive Vice President and Chair of the Program in Business and Finance at the King's College. Prior to joining the King's faculty, Brenberg worked in the financial services and medical device industries, as well as public policy research and philanthropy. He earned an MBA with distinction from Harvard Business School and an MPA from the Harvard Kennedy School. For his undergrad, Brenberg attended University of St. Thomas, which happens to be the school that our other intern, Reagan, is actually currently attending. When he isn't teaching at King's College, Professor Brenberg is a frequent guest on several Fox News and Fox Business programs and has written for many publications, including the USA Today, Forbes.com, The New York Post, and The Hill. His speeches have been covered by The Time and The Washington Post, and he regularly lectures for the Foundation for Economic Education and the American Enterprise Institute Values and Capitalism Project. While not exactly scholarly, Professor Brenberg also sports an outrageous 4.9 out of 5 on RateMyProfessor.com. In my 4 years of college, I've never seen a score that high, and I've checked out all of my professors I've ever had. And I believe that deserves a round of applause by itself. Please put your hands together again and join me in welcoming Professor Brenberg.
That. I had no idea that my score was where it was. Thanks for letting me know about that. Good morning to all of you. It's really a pleasure to be with you this morning. You know, there was a journalist who once asked the bank robber, Willie Sutton, why is it that you rob banks? And Willie Sutton famously replied, well, I rob banks because that's where the money is. Now, I'm here today to talk about entrepreneurship, not bank robbery. But my concern is that your peers, and you can tell me if I'm right on this or not, my concern is that your peers think bank robbery and entrepreneurship are basically the same thing. Whether you're starting a business or whether you're robbing a bank, you're basically just trying to get your hands on someone else's money. Now, that sounds like something that might be coming from the left. But I got to tell you, even believers in free markets often try to defend capitalism by saying it runs on self-interest. It's like we're trying to save this thing or persuade this thing by baptizing greed. What I want to suggest today is that I think we're getting the story wrong. We're getting the story wrong for your peers, and it's killing our imagination about how a free and prosperous society actually works. I want to see today if we can get to the real heart of entrepreneurship, and I want to do that by telling you the story of how somebody fixed my grandma's broken heart. This is a guy named Earl Bakken. Earl lived in a town not far from where I grew up in Minnesota. He's a typical Minnesota guy. Loves fishing, says you betcha all the time. He's typical in almost every way, except for one. Earl Bakken is a billionaire. Not just a billionaire, but a multi-billionaire. He doesn't live in Minnesota anymore. He lives, I don't want to say it's a better place. I guess you can decide. He lives in a 17,000 square foot home on the coast in Hawaii. I don't know if that's better than Minnesota, but that's pretty good. I love Minnesota. That's pretty good. So here's the question. Here's my question for you. How does this typical guy from a small town in Minnesota end up to be a billionaire? And what I found fascinating is that the answer to that question actually has something to do with my grandma, Dee. Now, my grandma's not a billionaire, but about a decade ago, my grandma had a broken heart. Earl Bakken helped fix that heart, and that's how he became a billionaire. Now, let me explain to you what I mean. And to do that, we're going to do a little bit of Medicine 101. Are you ready for that at 9 a.m. on a Saturday morning? I hope so. Okay, catch this, though. This is interesting. Here's your picture, okay? That's your heart. And off your heart comes this big tube called your aorta. It's like your body's blood superhighway. A lot of blood runs down that thing and it's pumped out of there very, very fast. It's great. It's what allows you to do what you do. The problem is, as you get older, that tissue in the wall of your aorta starts to weaken. And when it does, that blood running down your blood superhighway starts to get in between. The problem is it can start to pool. You can see it there. That's what that little red balloon is in the middle of that picture. And if it starts to pool, it can rupture. When that pocket ruptures, your life is over in a matter of minutes. About a decade ago, that's what my Grandma D had. And it was almost a miracle that we knew about it, because as dangerous as this thing is, it's almost impossible to detect unless something else is going on in your body. So the good news is we knew that Grandma D had this problem. The bad news was it's pretty hard to fix. Here's what has to happen, okay? So you've got this problem. You got to fix it, because if it ruptures, that's it. For most of the 20th century, the way that you fix this thing, this pocket in your aorta, was really, really traumatic. Remember, this is your body's blood superhighway, right? Like, your body needs this thing. Here's what you do to fix this problem. You've actually got to clamp off the flow of blood down your body's blood superhighway. Stop it. Once you've done that, you have to cut out that diseased portion of your aorta, which means you've got to make a big incision right down this person's abdomen. You take out that diseased portion of their aorta, and in its place, you sew this plastic tube. You're in the hospital with this surgery for days. You're in intensive care for days. You're in the hospital potentially for weeks, and you're at home recovering for months. I'm telling you this because that was the situation facing my grandma. And it's very hard for somebody her age to survive this thing. But the story for her and for me had a really, really interesting twist. Because the same summer she was diagnosed with that problem, I went to work for a company that offered a really, really different solution. Remember, with this solution, this open repair solution, the doctor has to work from the outside in a really big way. The company that I was working for that very summer had developed a solution that worked from the inside out. Instead of opening somebody up, you made a pen tip size hole in their leg. And you ran this little plastic tube with a wire inside it through that hole, and you run it up into that blood-filled sac in their aorta. You don't open them up. You go from the inside out. Once you're there, you twist the handle on that tube, and a little plastic sheath pops out, covering that diseased tissue causing the blood to flow back down through your aorta. You don't spend days in intensive care. You don't spend weeks in the hospital. You stay after the procedure a day, maybe two. Then you go home and you start living your life. A completely, radically different solution to this problem. So you can imagine, as a grandson, I'm thinking, this is awesome. I am so glad something like this exists. But as a professor and a guy who studies innovation and entrepreneurship, the question that popped into my mind is, how in the world did somebody come up with this thing? And what I was surprised to find is that the answer to that question actually led me to this old garage in Fridley, Minnesota. This is the garage that was owned by a guy, you might remember him, named Earl Bakken. And in 1947, that's Earl, that's that guy I showed you earlier, in 1947, he was in that garage working on repairing radios and television sets. But he noticed something interesting. This is after World War II, and he noticed at hospitals that they were using more and more electronic equipment, the kind of stuff that he knew how to work on. So he went to the University of Minnesota Hospital, just down the road, and he said to these guys, hey, can I help you out? You've got a lot of electronic equipment. Can I help you fix this stuff and keep it running? And they said, yeah. So he was wandering around the halls of that place looking for things to help repair. While he was there, there was a surgeon, this guy right here in the white lab coat, doing path-breaking work on little kids with heart defects. What he would do is he would repair their hearts, and when he was done, to help them recover, he'd have to hook them up to a pacemaker to keep the heart beating regularly. Now, I don't know if you've ever seen a pacemaker before. Today, they're these really, really little small things. Anybody ever seen a pacemaker or have family members? There's a lot of them out there. They're little things. That's not what a pacemaker looked like in the early 1950s. Not this little thing. This is what a pacemaker looked like in the early 1950s. It's like the size of a small microwave. You didn't get to wear the thing. You had to set it on a cart, and you had to wheel it around, which means the patient wasn't very mobile, right? But there was an even bigger problem, and you can actually kind of see it in the corner of the picture. If you wanted to power this thing, do you know what you had to do with it? Who said it? You had to plug it in to the wall. Now, do you see a problem with that? You're not doctors. We're not doctors here. Do you see a problem with that? Halloween night, 1957, there's a power outage at the University of Minnesota Hospital. That famous surgeon has a patient hooked up to a pacemaker. There's backup generators for the emergency room. There's no backup generators for the recovery rooms. The power's out for 3 hours. He loses that patient. So he wants a solution for this. How do we get around the limitations of that equipment? He's doing surgery that is changing people's lives in ways they've never been changed before, but he's got a bottleneck, and it's right here. So he goes to the physics students at the University of Minnesota, the graduate students in physics, because these are the guys who understand this stuff, and he says to them, can you help me solve this problem? And the answer was they couldn't. But over this same period of time, this famous surgeon had gotten to know that tinkerer working out of a garage, wandering the halls at the hospital. And so this surgeon went to Earl Bakken and said, "Earl, here's my problem. Can you think of a way to fix this?" Earl went back to his garage, and with the help of some popular mechanics magazines, in 4 weeks, he came back with that. Do you see it? That's the surgeon. That's one of his patients. The thing around the kid's neck is the thing that Earl came up with. It's the size of a few decks of cards. It's battery powered. It's mobile. And what's really interesting, I think, is at this point, regulations around medical devices were far, far lower than they are today. He could start using this device almost immediately on these kids. That's the beginning of the pacemaker that you and I know today. Now, 60 years later, there's over 1 million of these things implanted every year. That's kind of what they look like right now. And actually, this story got even more personal for me about 3 weeks ago because my dad just got a pacemaker implanted in his body. Now, Earl Bakken started with pacemakers, but he didn't stop there. He enlisted the help of more and more people, and they started finding ways to treat other problems with your ears, your nose, your throat, your spine, your stomach, all sorts of other areas in your body where a medical device could help. And that's why Earl Bakken is a billionaire today, because the company that he started, Medtronic, is now worth over $100 billion. That's the story of the small town guy from Fridley. But here's what I think is interesting. When I speak to audiences like this, or I speak to my students, I often ask people, "Hey, tell me about professions out there in the world. Tell me about people out there in the world who really give back. Tell me about the people who really serve the world." And I bet you can imagine the answers that I get. They're probably the answers that you would give me. I hear answers like counselors, and teachers, and social workers, and nonprofit workers, and nurses. And I gotta tell you, those are great answers. I totally agree. But do you know an answer I almost never get to that question of who gives back and who really serves in the world? Nobody, I bet you're gonna guess this, nobody ever tells me, "Yeah, businessman, that's somebody who gives back." I think that is so interesting. In fact, it's usually the opposite. If I were to say to somebody, "Businessman, tell me what comes into your thought bubble," I think what comes into their thought bubble typically is, "Business people don't give back. If you want to succeed in business, you actually have to find a way to take. You've got to find a way to take advantage of people," right? Your customers, your employees, the people who supply your stuff. That's what business people do. I mean, if you think about the stories we hear about business people, isn't that the narrative that we typically get? If you watch the news, do you look at the headlines? I think that's a story we get. Several years ago, I had a student walk into my office, a good student, and she wanted to come in and talk to me about career advice. And she said, "Hey, you know, I'm really interested in going into the nonprofit sphere. I want to go work for a nonprofit someday." I said, "Okay, that's great. I've worked for nonprofits before. That's great. Tell me about your interest in working in nonprofits." And see, she told me, you know, why she wanted to do that, and she was talking about maybe different nonprofits that interested her, and I kept asking her questions, you know, "Why do you want to do this? What do you hope to accomplish? What's the purpose of this?" And I noticed something interesting, because I like to read body language. I noticed that as I asked her more and more questions about why she wanted to do this, she started to move her eyes from my eyes to the floor. And her posture started to change down, down. And I thought this was so interesting. About midway through this conversation, she was looking at the floor. She wasn't looking at me anymore. And she had that posture of sort of like she was kind of dejected. I quit asking her questions. We sat there in silence for, 10, 15 seconds maybe. And then she looked up at me. I'll never forget this. And she said, "Is it okay if I just want to go into business?" It was like she was admitting to me that she had been engaging in underage drinking. I'm a business professor. I could not believe that this was happening in front of me. It was relatively early in my teaching career. I had this bright young woman in front of me, and she was begging forgiveness from a business professor to want to go into business. Now, you may say that sounds ridiculous. But I wonder, in your heart of heart, whether you've thought similarly about what you're going to do. I actually don't blame her for feeling this way. I don't blame her for having this intuition, because I think the story she's gotten from people in her life who matter has been a story that says if you want to make a difference in the world, you got to do it without making money, because those things are diametrically opposed. I mean, think about the narratives that form our imagination as a society, our popular imagination. Think about the people in the stories you consume that represent business. I'll give you my favorite example, this guy. Have you seen the Lego movie, the original Lego movie? I love that movie. I love watching that movie with my kids, but it always causes me some pain because the bad guy is named First President Business. And if you know anything about cronyism, that's a problem. But eventually, Lord Business. The business guy is the supreme bad guy. Now, that's just one example, but let me ask you a question. Can you think of a film that you've seen where the businessman or the businesswoman is the good guy because he or she is a businessman or a businesswoman? Can you think of a film where the business person is the good guy because they're a business person? Now, I'm just going to throw that out there as sort of a rhetorical question to you. I think about this, and I could come up with a couple of examples that almost answer that question, almost. And when I actually solicit answers from audiences, almost always they will give me these two characters. The two people they can think of are the two that I think of, and they're these guys. Did anybody think of Tony Stark or Bruce Wayne? Okay, so okay, listen to this. Now, I want you to catch this. Are these guys business guys? Yeah. Are they the heroes in their story because they're business guys? Yeah, yeah. So now we can try to go into some of the nuance around it. Guess who doesn't catch the nuance? Everybody else. Think about this. Think about how much stories like this dominate the way we think about the world. Okay? And think about how few of those stories are populated by businessmen and women who are portrayed as heroic. It's not an accident that young woman walked into my office and felt like she had to apologize for being interested in business. Because best case, she could maybe end up like Bruce Wayne, sleeping through board meetings and then making it up in the back end by being a superhero somehow. Maybe giving it all back to a charity or going to volunteer someday. That's the best we've got, folks. Entrepreneurship and business will not survive as pillars of a free and prosperous society if the stories we tell ourselves only get as good as this. Do you see that? Can you see that? Now look, I'm not here to tell you today that businessmen and women are saints. I'm too realistic for that. The world is full of broken people, and there's as many broken people in the realm of business as there is in any other realm. But here's the interesting thing about how the market works. The interesting thing about how the market works is that the minute you do something successful in the marketplace, the minute Earl Bakken creates a pacemaker, a new pacemaker that works, the minute he produces that thing and makes money selling it to somebody else, do you know what he creates, what else he creates at that very same moment? I will tell you, it's something he never intended to create. He probably, deep down, wishes he hadn't have created it. But he cannot help but create it the minute he makes money selling his first pacemaker. Do you know what I'm talking? What do you know what he created?
Job opportunities for others.
He did, but he loves creating job opportunities. He's happy to do that. Please come work for me and we can all be successful together. Yes, he does create that, but he wants that. But when he makes that first pacemaker and he makes money on it, he makes something at the same time that he's not interested in making. No business person is interested in creating this when they make money, but invariably they do. Do you know what it is? You got to catch this. This is the hidden beauty of markets for all of us, though it's the big thing that keeps you up at night if you're the businessman or businesswoman. Did you have your hand up? What does he create? The minute he makes money on that new kind of pacemaker, he makes something else. Yeah, what, back there. Why? You're absolutely right. Why? Okay, it's a new technology, but what creates a new competition? How does that work? Earl Bakken makes pacemaker, makes money. What happens? Yes? Someone else sees it. Because guess what money is? Money is like this big billboard that says, look here, this works, there's opportunity. Earl Bakken makes money. People look at how he makes money, and what do they say to themselves? Say it loud. Ooh, I never thought of that, but now that I see it, I've got a way to do it better. Do you see that? Earl Bakken made this pacemaker, and it works, but the minute he did that, he started making all these guys. And this is like the tiniest of slivers of the people who are out there in the world. Okay, competition. The word competition sounds hard-edged, right? Like, ooh, competition. Markets create competition. I don't like competition. That sounds tough. What is competition? What actually is competition? All it is, catch this. Please catch this, because I don't think people are going to tell you this otherwise, and you might not see it. Competition is simply the reality of people in the world who want to serve people you're serving better than you. Do you see this? Competition is the presence of people ready to serve. That's what Medtronic, that's what Earl Bakken created the minute they created that pacemaker. The idea that I can serve your customer better than you. And do you know who the easiest competitor in the world is to beat? It's the guy who's greedy. The the greedy guy is easy to beat. He's focused on himself, not the customer. Service eats greed for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. The most fearsome competitors are the ones who are most laser-focused on their customers. You know, we hear this line that, you know, free markets really exist to serve business interests. People who like free markets are interested simply in helping out businesses, preserving business interests. But are you starting to catch that that's got it actually exactly backward? A really open free market with a lot of competition isn't there to serve the interests of the businesses that exist today. It exists to allow other people to put them out of business. Do you see that? Markets don't protect businesses. Markets make them incredibly vulnerable to other people with better ideas. People who want to protect you, consumers, through regulation actually end up protecting businesses in the market today by removing the threat of service from other competitors. I want you to see that. I think our imagination has it backwards. Markets don't exist to serve businesses. Markets exist to serve you and protect you from the threat of greed from the businesses in the market today. Do you see that? Until we start to understand the real service at the heart of entrepreneurship, we're not going to change people's minds. If our message is, hey, self-interest makes it all work, we're never going to change anyone's mind because we're not going to change their heart. But their heart will change if they see that actually at the root of what happens in the marketplace is the imperative and the desire to make someone's life better. That's what starts to move the needle for people. Here's what I think it all means. Let me sum it up for you. I think you're going to go out into the marketplace, you're going to go out to look for a job, you're going to go out to work, and you're going to be confronted with what appears to be a dichotomy. People are going to say to you, you can make money, or you can make the world a better place, but you can't do both. And I want to suggest that that's backwards. That's exactly opposite. If you want to make money over the long term, if you really want to prosper, then you better find a way to make the world a better place. Earl Bakken started making a lot of money back in the 1950s, not because he was trying to fix his own heart or the heart of anybody else he knew. He was trying to fix the heart of a kid who he never met before and who he would never spend time with again. That's where his fortune started. And he and his colleagues continue to make money today, not because they're fixing their own problems, but because they're fixing the problems of people like my grandma Dee. They're finding innovative new ways to do this. Entrepreneurship doesn't start, can't start, and it can't run on greed. It has to start with service. And what I love is sometimes entrepreneurs and business people can even fix a broken heart. Okay, guys, that's my talk. Thanks so much for hearing it. I've got a few minutes for questions if you have questions about what we're talking about. So what objections do you have? What elaborations do you want? Where did I go wrong? Where did I go right? Be entrepreneurial. Come on up and ask a question. And for those on the web as well.
Hi, yes, this is from Brenda in San Diego. What advice would you give a high school student who wants to pursue business, and how do you calculate the cost benefit of a degree from a certain college?
That's a great question. Thank you, Brenda, for the question. I teach at a college. Okay, so all cards on the table. I teach at a college. I teach in a business program. I think there's a lot of value in that. But here's what I would say. Here's the problem that I think you face and that a lot of high school students face. You face the pressure of walking down a certain path that has a lot of societal credibility. In other words, let me paint a picture. Suppose you're at your graduation party and your uncle asks you, so Johnny, what are you going to be doing in the future now? What are you going to be doing next? There are some things you can say that will allow him to pat you on the head. If you say, hey, I'm going to go to college and I'm going to study pre-law so that I can go to law school and become a successful attorney, do you think the uncle is going to be pleased to hear that? Is that a societally acceptable thing to do? Oh, you bet. Nobody ever chastises you for going to law school. So what becomes the temptation? Oh, I'm going to go down that path because I want people to pat me on the head. Are you a people pleaser? Honestly, I bet you are because you're in this room. You're motivated, you're capable, you love pleasing people. That will be the hardest thing for you to break because you're going to want to go down the paths that other people say are okay. But to Brenda's question, what should a young person do who wants to get into business? Well, the answer is business is an inherently practical, forward-looking enterprise, which means if you're not out in the marketplace testing what it is you think you're interested in, you're not going to learn. You cannot hope to become a competent business person by sitting in a classroom. You can't do that. That's more likely to make you a terrible business person over the long term. That doesn't mean don't go to college. But what it means is if you're going to go to school to study business or finance, you better go someplace that is really interested in pushing you out of the classroom as much as possible, as quickly as possible, so that you're actually working for businesses that are doing real things in the real world. Do you see this? Your temptation is going to be to want to choose a paint-by-number path. But there's nothing about this story or any great story in business that's paint by number. Don't do that. You should be thinking about a life that's much more experimental than that. Testing ideas. You think you want to be something. You think you want to go into finance. How can you test that? The worst way to test that is to go get a 4-year degree in finance. That's a really expensive, really time-consuming way to test that interest. What's a better thing? How about ask your parents or your relatives if they know somebody who works in finance, and can you spend a day with them? Can you have an informational interview with them? That's a cheap, quick way to test whether this might be something you're interested in. Do you see that? I'd love to save you time and money in your lives, and the best way I can do that is to tell you to think about your career endeavors as experiments, not jumping off of big cliffs. And the most important thing you can do in the short term is learn to resist the pressure to do things that cause people who love you to pat you on the head. They might be pleasing to those people's ears, but they might not be helpful for your vocation. Okay, Brenda, long answer. Thank you for the question. Great question. Yep.
Hi, my name is John Perry. I go to Agora High School, and my question is,
Is that in California?
Yes.
Great, awesome.
Yeah, down in near Westlake Village. But
okay. I don't know where any of these places are. I'm from Minnesota and New York, but I love it. That's great.
My question is, who do you think is behind this perpetuation or this idea that big business or businessmen, in general, not obviously there are a few bad apples, of course,
of
but
course,
in general,
yeah.
Who do you think is behind the myth that they're all greedy and selfish, and what do you think we can do to change this?
Well, the easy answer is to say people who have an ideological grudge against capitalism. Okay, that's the easy answer. Can I turn it around, though? You know who I blame? I blame us. I blame you. And I blame me. Because we allow ourselves to be so blinded to the beauty of what happens around us in our lives. There's a G.K. Chesterton quote that I love. Catch this. This is one that I think I want to stick in your head. He says, "We are perishing not for want of wonders, but for want of wonder." We live in a cloud. We live in a day-to-day cloud. We take for granted everything that we have, and we don't call attention to the beauty of what's happening in the marketplace, in the world around us. Think about products you love, and think about the last time you stopped to learn the story of where that product came from, and think about the last time somebody told you the story of where a great product came from. So here's one that's been, I've been convicted about one. I'll tell you one of mine. I don't celebrate Cheerios nearly enough as I should. Cheerios. When's the last time you celebrated Cheerios? You sat down for breakfast, you poured a bowl of Cheerios, and you went, yes, Cheerios. I love these things. Do you ever do that? Do you ever do that with any of your cereal besides Cinnamon Toast Crunch because it's just so good every time you eat it? It's not good for you. It's not a commercial, by the way, for anybody. Cheerios. My kids eat Cheerios every morning. I eat Cheerios every morning. Cheerios are a miracle. Think about, okay, you eat Cheerios for breakfast, right? Breakfast is the most important meal of the day. Guys, it's really, really important. We talk about the billions of people around the world who don't have an opportunity to get an education that even approximates the education you get. You know one of the big reasons why? Because they don't have the physical strength to do it. They can't sit in a chair and focus because they're malnourished. They don't get to eat something like Cheerios in the morning. But school kids across this country and many others have the opportunity to get this cheap, really nutritious breakfast that can get them out the door and into the world to play and to learn. It costs us almost nothing to nourish our kids. That's a miracle. And the outcome is you sitting in these seats. Cheerios helps you read and write. We're more literate because of things like Cheerios. We're more active. We're more creative. You're smiling and laughing at me, but you know it. You know you're like, darn, shoot, I have not appreciated Cheerios enough in my life, or Raisin Bran or whatever it is. And that's the stupidest example I can think of. But think of all the stuff you value in your life and how little you celebrate it. Why do the bad narratives predominate? Because we're not creative enough to tell the good ones that are hidden in our lives. So you think you're creative? The most countercultural creative thing you can do is to make a story of Cheerios and have people like it and buy into it. Not because the company makes money and serves shareholders, but because it keeps kids in the realm of possibility to get education and to play. I mean, that's my challenge to you. Tell a different story. You want to change bad culture? Best way to do it is to make new culture. So make better culture. Be creative. So I started by saying I blame you, but actually what I'm saying is I challenge you. I challenge me. Tell a different story. That will start to change people's minds. Thanks for the question.
Thank you.
Yep. I get fired up about Cheerios these days. I don't know why. I just do.
My name is Adam Huser. I go to Providence Academy in Plymouth, Minnesota.
Oh, yes. Awesome. Can I clap for you? Nobody else clapped at that. I'm going to clap at that. That's awesome. You're from Minnesota. That's great.
I hope this doesn't come off as disrespectful, but my question is...
You know it's going to come off as disrespectful if you preface it that way.
My question is, if you have these great ideas as to how to succeed in business, why don't you do it yourself?
No, that's a really fair question. It's not disrespectful. I would ask that question of me as well. And what it comes down to is, what are your skill sets? Like, what are you equipped and enabled to do? I have my respect level for the small businessman and the small businesswoman is off the charts because of the skill set they have to do what they do. I had to bring my car in to be serviced the other day. I brought it into Russell's Automotive in North Branch, Minnesota. It's a two-person shop. This guy has got cars littering his parking lot. Everyone wants to bring their car to him because he does good, honest work. And he says to me, I got to tell you, the hardest thing for me isn't actually finding my customers. It's finding good people who can help me do what I do and then managing them. This guy knows more about cars than I do, but he also has a more intuitive sense about people than I think I do. He's better at business than I am, but there's something I'm better than him at, I think. And that is, at the ground level, he's going to beat me every day when it comes to turning a profit in his business. But for whatever reason, my skill set is at a higher level to integrate these things that I see and then offer a picture that he probably can't articulate. He's a really smart guy, but that's not his skill set. He's not going to get up and do something like this and maybe move the needle on how you think about entrepreneurship and markets. So actually, I went into business. I worked in finance. I worked at Medtronic. I got a sense for what that world involves. But what I really found is actually the thing I did comparatively better than others was integrated at a level higher and help people kind of understand what happens in that world and make sense of it. I really wish I knew how to work on motors. I would love to be a restorer of classic cars and open a business doing that. I would love that. I can barely hold a screwdriver. But I can get up with you and these guys, and you may not agree with me, but I can at least get you thinking, and that might change your trajectory a little bit. And so that's where I've gone. And by the way, that's not un-entrepreneurial. I've created new classes. I've created new forms where I can get this message out through different kinds of media. So I think in my own way, there's a lot of I'm here with you guys. I've created this opportunity to be here with you guys. So there are some entrepreneurial things. By the way, thank you for asking this. Can I say one more thing? The point of this talk is not to say you need to become an entrepreneur. Please don't feel that pressure or that burden. You can do entrepreneurial things within the confines of an existing organization. My point is, appreciate what animates entrepreneurship and gain a new appreciation for the idea that it's service, not simply self-interest. So I didn't find that disrespectful at all. I hope that was actually a helpful answer to your question. Thank you very much for asking.
Thank you.
All right, this is from Caroline in Baton Rouge. Regulations only give the government more opportunity to pick winners and losers, feeding crony relationships. How do we make the conversation about regulating the regulators instead of the entrepreneurs?
Thank you, Caroline, for the question. There's no way you're going to regulate the regulators because then you need somebody to regulate the regulators of the regulators, and you need somebody to regulate the regulators of the regulators of the regulators. You see that? It's an infinite regress. That's not going to work. Let me just make the answer to this very short. Here's the thing we don't understand. There's a problem in the marketplace. People say we need regulation. But I think one of the main features of the talk I just gave you is that, in fact, in a free market system with no government regulation, let's say, there is a ton of regulation. There is a ton of regulation in every market system. Who provides it? Who regulates in a market system, even if government regulation is absent? Who does that?
Customers.
It's you guys. Where'd you buy your shirt from today, young man? That shirt you're wearing, where'd you get it from? No, this guy. I like it. It's a nice blue Oxford shirt. Yeah, it's kind of got like a blue thing going on in the collar. Nice blue buttons. You just like blindly wandered into some store here. Can I have this? No, did you get it from J. Crew or did you get it from? It's okay. You can make it up if you want to.
Okay.
J. Cole? Is that like a Cole Haan combination of J. Crew? Okay, so this example is not working very well because we don't know where we shop for our clothes. But here's the point. You bought that instead of some other shirt, right? Now, I don't know how sophisticated your thought process was, but not very, apparently. But that act alone of buying that and not something else is an act of regulation. You're saying, I prefer what you do to what you do. And as long as I prefer what you do, as long as your service, your level of quality is not up to par, I'm going to purchase over here, not over here. Do you see that your feet, the stores that your feet lead you into, figuratively speaking, that's how you regulate what businesses do. So one thing I think people have to understand is that our choices are powerful, and they actually provide the most regulation of anything in a marketplace. And I love the fact that regulation in a market is so diffuse and it's put into our hands. That's a ton of power. And with social media, you have even more. If you love that shirt, you can talk to your millions of followers on Twitter or Instagram or whatever, and you can say, you gotta buy these shirts, they're better than anybody else. Boy, that's a powerful signal. Has anybody ever tweeted at a company because they had a bad experience or a good one? Have you ever done that? Did you get a response?
Yeah.
Almost right away?
Yeah.
It's amazing, isn't it? Your ability to regulate has gone up exponentially because of things like Twitter, because these companies are more afraid of you sharing your bad experience than a government regulator coming down on them for something else. So there's a little imagination around what you can do as an individual to help provide really effective regulation in the marketplace. Thanks for the question. I appreciate it.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello, my name is Tristan Mahal, and I'm from Tassler High School, which is about 3 hours north of here.
Awesome.
And recently you've seen a lot of young people, they've been out saying that, you know, there's no more room at the top, and how the people at the top are kicking everyone else down. There's no chance for them to be able to reach the top of entrepreneurship.
Yeah.
And I just want to know, how would you kind of counter that?
Oh, man, who wants to be at the top? I mean, I'm not sure what they mean, but if they mean like sitting in the top of a heap of a huge corporation. So one of my first, I'll get to an answer to that question. Let me tell you an experience I had. When I was, shortly after I graduated college, one of my first jobs was with a really large financial services insurance company. And I don't know how this happened, but one of the jobs that I got in the course of being there was the special assistant to the CEO of this Fortune 500 company. Okay, so I was there with him all the time, helping him put together his presentations, helping him get ready for meetings. I was just kind of his right-hand guy. This was a really interesting job for a kid who's 23, 24 years old. Okay, but one of the things that I noticed, he ran this, you know, tens of thousands of employees at this company. I walked up to his office one day. Okay, it was an early morning. I'd gotten into work a little bit early. He was on the top floor because he's at the top of the heap. Took the elevator up there, kind of wandered around the corner and started to head toward his office. And from my angle, I could get a view into his office and had the great windows, you know, all the things you think about with a CEO and his desk. But as I turned the corner, I saw him sitting at his desk with his face flat on the desk. And I thought, what in the world is going on? It looked like, you know, like somebody who had just given up on life. And at that moment, as a 23, 24-year-old guy, what I realized is this person I work for on top of this big heap has more stress and strain on his shoulders, so many people depended on him, than I can ever possibly understand. Now, that's not a counsel to say don't aspire to be the CEO or on top, but I think the beauty of our marketplace today is that it's not as dominated by the big companies as it used to be. It's not the case that you have to climb the ladder to do something fulfilling. Web technology, different ways of reaching consumers, has opened up so many more possibilities for people to pursue the things that they love. I mean, think about the platforms that you maybe shop on. Think about all the new online retailers and the new possibilities that gives you to buy new products that you couldn't buy 20 or 30 years ago. I love Etsy. Did anybody ever shop on Etsy? It's probably more of like an old person's thing. Sorry, I didn't mean to offend you by saying the old person thing. I love Etsy because it's full of people who never would have had the opportunity to sell these creative things that they produce 30 years ago. It would have been too hard. Today, this platform allows them to self-direct the things that they want to do. I actually think it's exactly, if you want to climb to the top of the big heap, it's always been hard. It's never been easy. That's a myth to think it's ever been easy. But the point today is you don't have to do that. You can do really creative, awesome, collaborative things without having to figure out how to climb that ladder. You can do it because you can reach customers and serve them in ways that you could never do it before, thanks to the technologies that innovators have put together for us. Does that make sense? So I actually think people think somehow the opportunity has been foreclosed in our world. I totally reject that. I think opportunity is more available than ever, but it looks different. And it does actually require a little bit more entrepreneurship than it did 30, 40, 50 years ago. But folks, I think that's a good thing because you were made to be creative. So why wouldn't we celebrate a world that values our creativity more now than maybe it used to? Thanks for the question.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Benjamin and I'm from the homeschool.
Awesome.
Yeah.
We homeschool our kids too. I love it. Great.
Yeah. So when there is an economy that is in another country that runs itself in a different way than your economy runs, in a way that makes them inherently unfair towards you in any trade relations, or the benefits would the benefits of free trade outweigh the level playing field created by tariffs, or would it make more sense to have tariffs to make it so that even though you wouldn't be having free trade, you would still have fair trade?
Best thing in the world at the end of the day is free trade. Okay, I'm not trying to make like a big political statement. I'm saying that when people have the opportunity to work together freely without restraints, it produces good things. That's why we love that. That's why the 50 states in the United States, we wanted to make sure that people could move and they could trade and they could work together. Okay, so free trade is what you want. Okay, now the question I think you're asking is, well, what about? And I think this is a very legitimate question. This is a hard one to answer. What about the case of somebody who undermines one of the pillars of free trade? Free trade works, and it really only works well if property rights in your society are strong. If I know what's mine, and you can't take it unless I give it to you in exchange for something else. Do you see that?
Yeah.
Trade doesn't work without property rights. So we, in this country, have done a pretty good job of enforcing property rights. The problem with trading partners sometimes, which shall go unnamed,
is that they don't have property rights.
And I think this is where you have a legitimate case. If people are in a country that has a policy of undermining and disregarding the property that people own in another country, if they steal that property, free trade really isn't possible in that scenario. Do you see that?
Yeah.
I'm not free to trade with you. If I want to trade with you, you're forcing me to give up something that I own against my will. That's not free trade. That's some approximation or a mixture of kind of free trade and coercion. It's not free trade. So in the world that we live in, we should all want to get to free trade. None of us should be happy with things that get in the way of people working together collaboratively. But I think we should also say that's only going to work if everybody around the table is committed to not stealing other people's stuff.
And not everyone is.
And so that's where the question goes from economic theory to political practice. How do you fix that problem? And I don't know the answer to that question. We're clearly trying one route to doing that right now. And I think the answer is prove that your method works. Mm-hmm. Show us that your method of negotiating this works. But if the use of tariffs in the name of solving that problem, that property rights problem, merely ends up in us with more and more tariffs, then we will have lost. We will suffer, we will reduce prosperity, and that's to our detriment, and it's to the detriment of other trading partners around the world. So there's a clear end goal, but free trade's not happening if property rights are undermined. And solving that problem is a question of diplomacy, negotiation, and I don't think we know the answer to that one yet. Mm-hmm. It's not paint by number. So I not a dodge of your question, but just I think a fuller context of how to think about that.
Thank
that make
you.
Sense? Thank you for the question. I appreciate it.